very easy. So about 1.5 years ago, there was a big conference in Bonn connected with my 65th birthday. Actually, it was 11 months earlier than the birthday, but the conference was just before my 66th. And in the week before the conference, Ken Ono, who was one of the organizers of the conference but actually couldn't stay, but he was in Bonn the week before, he asked me a very puzzling question and kind of as a challenge. And so I went home, thought about it, told him the next morning I'd spent 3 or 4 hours, kind of half of the answer. And then the next day I finished, gave him the complete answer to his question. This question made no mention of the Riemann hypothesis, the Riemann zeta function. It was on something completely different called the partition function, which every mathematician, every number theorist knows very well. Then he left because he had another conference to go to. 1 week later in the mail, I got a paper with four authors, Ken Ono, his two postdocs, Griffin and Rolen, and myself, on the Riemann hypothesis and application. I had no idea that that's why was why he had asked me this original problem. It turned out that what he asked me was a kind of a toy problem to prove something like what was needed for this paper on the Riemann hypothesis, but in a simpler situation. And so he gave me the simpler one so that I wouldn't be prejudiced, and I'd solved it. So then based on my solution, they wrote up the solution of the full problem. Actually, it turned out it was not yet a complete solution. The analysis turned out to be much more complicated than they had thought, and to adapt what I'd done for the toy problem to the Riemann case actually took us another 8 months till it was correct. So it was not finished in a week, but eventually we finished it, and the paper then was submitted and accepted by the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science. About the elegant, there was something very beautiful in this toy problem, which did not have to do with the Riemann zeta function, but with what's called the partition function, another famous function, famous because Euler found it, it studied its properties, and later Ramanujan and Hardy proved wonderful results about it. And when I solved that toy problem, what I actually showed was that the same answer, the same method, would apply to a very large class of functions. And there was a kind of a universal answer. What you had to show is that certain numbers, these are the roots of some polynomial, would eventually, if this parameter that I talked about became big enough, would eventually all move apart and become distinct. That was the problem. But what I found with the computer and then proved was that they didn't just become distinct, they stabilized, always did the same thing. These zeros, these numbers, always became in the limit, the same numbers, independent of the other parameter, but also of the problem. It was true for partitions, it would be true for any generic function. And that was the one that was then used for the Riemann zeta function. It was the same, they had the same limiting value. And this really is an elegant result. It's very surprising. You ask something about certain numbers, roots of a certain polynomial, and then it turns out that the answer is always the same. The problem can come from many, many different sources. There's a parameter that goes to infinity, so you have a limiting distribution, and that limit is always the same. It's a universal answer. So that is something I think any mathematician consider elegant, because you don't expect to think each time it will be different, but no, it's always the same. There's a universal answer, and this was certainly a nice discovery. So that, I think, is actually the most interesting part of the paper, that there's this universal formula that you can apply to the toy problem of partitions, to the not-so-toy problem about the Riemann zeta function, but in principle to many other questions. I don't know any important applications, but in theory, many other questions of this sort. And you will always find the same answer. So that was a big surprise. Well, that's an amusing story. So many years ago, maybe 30 years ago, I was having a conversation with Enrico Bombieri, who's a very famous Italian number theorist, but he worked most of his life now in America, Fields Medalist, absolutely one of the great living analytic number theorists. And he was visiting Bonn. We've known each other for years. And we got in conversation about the Riemann hypothesis. He was then and still is a firm believer, like a believer in God. You just cannot imagine that it's not true. It's an article of faith. And I was taking the point of view of devil's advocate. Probably it's true, maybe it's true, maybe it's not true. But I would say, there's not enough evidence. I would be happy to make a bet 50-50 either way. So he immediately, Dom, let's make a bet. So then we decided what? So we said, 2 bottles of good wine, because he's a wine connoisseur, I'm less, but we both love good wine. But then we had to decide, how will we ever decide who won? Because if somebody proves the Riemann hypothesis, he wins. If somebody disproves it, I win. But what if nobody ever solves it and we go to our graves? We didn't want, we wanted a criterion. So I offered, which was stupid of me, I said, okay, look, Enrico, today, that was 30 years ago, I don't remember exactly, 3 million zeros of the Riemann zeta function have been computed, and none of them is a counterexample of the conjecture yet. If they succeed in getting 300 million, 100 times more, and they haven't yet disproved it, I will confess defeat and I will pay up. So then 10 years went by, because this was a very complicated calculation, and I knew they wouldn't be, people wouldn't go from 3 million to 4 million, there's no point, you have to make serious progress. But 10 years later, computers had become more advanced, and so two teams of scientists and mathematicians, one, Brent and his colleagues in Australia, one, Teril and his colleagues in Amsterdam, worked, and they worked in competition, but also writing letters to each other, no email yet. And they decided, they wrote preprints which came out at the same time, still no archives, so by mail, and they stopped at 200 million. So I breathed a sigh of relief, my bet is still okay, it will now, since they stopped at 200 million, it will be another 10 years till people go to a billion. Of course, I knew I would eventually lose, but I have a few more years. But I have a friend, Hendrik Lenstra, another very famous number theorist, Dutch. He is Dutch, he's from Amsterdam, and he told, he knew about my bet. So he told Terile secretly, why don't you guys go on, that Don will lose his bet. So then they went on, and they went to 300 million. So I lost my bet, I gave von Gehry his 2 bottles of wine, one he shared with me, so I drank half of this bottle. But to do that calculation took 700 hours of CPU time, central processing unit. That was not like today's central processors on your pen or on your smartphone. Then it was a building the size of the ICTP, and 1 hour of CPU time cost officially $1,000. Actually, the university never paid. It was, you know, grant money. It was black at night. They would let it run when nobody... But in principle, so in principle, these people in Australia spent $700,000, 700 hours at $1,000 an hour, just so that I would lose my bet. So I always joked that I've drunk the most expensive bottle of wine in history, because this bottle of wine cost $350,000 and the other bottle also $350,000. Of course, it didn't really cost that, probably it cost $100, the actual bottle. But that's the story of the bet. I'm not sure I prefer it, but it's kind of what I often end up doing. Because first of all, it says I'm actually very good at it. I mean, really concrete problems like recognizing numbers or solving some identity, I'm good at. I enjoy. Most mathematicians don't care about it, and if they do, they're not as good. And so I have a certain reputation, and quite often people ask me, sometimes by email, I have many papers with people I've never met, that somebody sends me an email, I have a problem that somebody said you might be able to work on. Sometimes I can do it, and sometimes I can't. Sometimes it takes a day, sometimes it takes 6 months. But I like that kind of challenge. I mean, it's not the main object in mathematical life to solve challenge problems, but it's fun. And so it's happened very often. And sometimes those, I become the co-author of the paper. And sometimes I say, no, I don't want to be a co-author because I didn't contribute enough. But they said, no, your solution is important. Then I write an appendix. And the appendix is written by Don Zagier, appendix, you know, proof of statement, you know, 4.2. And so I have, I think, something like 25 of my papers are not papers by me, they're appendices by me to papers of other people. But often the other authors say, no, no, this is more than appendix. We really, this was a crucial point, and so you should be a co-author. And a few times it's been very embarrassing, because then people assume I know that subject, because I'm the author of, some of these papers are quite well known and very important, but not because of my contribution, but I solved some problem that the authors needed.